So again, thank you, Philippe. It's great to share the work with you. Also, you know, I feel always we are sharing as colleagues and as people that share some affinities with some sensibilities as well. I call the charge space, you know, I like very much this book, The Charge Void, by Allison and Peter Smithson, where they say that, where they write, and I quote, "The space between speaks to the sky. The space between puts a charge into the sky." And I like to think as humans being agents, and we humans activate the sky by assigning it with meaning and mythological significance, infusing economic value while harvesting meteorological activity for energy production, embracing it with ideas of pleasure, delight, and wonder, and also aligning it and charging it with anthropogenic matter. I think this for us, perhaps now, let's put it in the now context, is particularly strange and urgent. And I was just reading last week, in the context of the new sanctions against Russia, the Prime Minister Mario Draghi said that, and I quote, "All the allied countries are wondering what can be done to stop Russia. We are following what the European Union decides. And I believe the question is between peace and having working radiators or air conditioning in summer. I think this is the question we must ask ourselves." So this is actually, it's a message for us also as architects, as designers, to think how we're going to build our built environment. And it's not only this question, it's also about what the new European community designates for clean energy, about the new European Bauhaus, all these ambitions to work without with a lesser footprint in energy. For our disciplines, this is one of the, it's very important because we are one of the biggest contributors to the releasing of greenhouse gas emissions related to energy consumption. This is numbers from the US, so let's take it into with a certain tint of salt. But just the HVAC systems emit close to 45% of the CO2 in its overall measure, you know, those are heating and cooling. So the question is, how can we reduce this? And we are always working very hard to make a point that this is necessary. So what can we designers, policymakers, consumers, et cetera, do about it? And how can the design of our neighborhoods and cities, buildings and open spaces support well-being with a reduction of energy consumption? Something that I would like to share with you is also the, you know, the factors that determine comfort. And they are like these three bars, the bars about physiological factors. And here there's a bunch of them. Age, we know that, for instance, older people are much more vulnerable to heat stress or to the shifts of temperatures. Gender, we know that women tend to feel colder. And there was a very interesting article in the New York Times a few years ago, why men, you know, are comfortable in offices because they are wearing their suits, and women with their nice dresses tend to feel colder. And they realize that the parameters, the protocols for air conditioning were more regulated to lower temperatures, meaning to men and their suits. The thermal history, where you're coming from, your metabolism and activity, climatic identity, and clothing, of course. And then there are other environmental factors. And this is something that Philippe has been writing and rallying for the last decades about. Those are wind, long wave radiation, the heat that is emitted from the materials or the surfaces that have been receiving the sunlight, short wave radiation, air temperature or the mean radiant temperature of the bubble that kind of surrounds you, and the relative humidity. Very important humidity, particularly on climates that are really humid and hot. And then there are the physiological, the psychological factors. You have the mood, you have the company. Yeah, we can feel hotter with certain company or colder with certain company. And then you have the notion of ambient, such as sound, colors, textures, contrasts, the scale and density, cultural perception, even reflections of certain materials. And among this, design can actually sculpt this, can work with these elements. And that's a lot. Something that I've been also very interested is, you know, also on the threshold between architecture and landscape. Yeah, I noticed that this is in Portuguese. And thinking about, and I'm sure Philippe has been pushing a lot also for this, is the showcasing of these invisible forces that affects us. So this is also, you know, working with Philippe and perhaps, you know, listening to me a little bit today, is also an encouragement for you to have agency in representing this, let's say, these metabolic articulations and interactions that is very difficult to say, to describe. Only by showing them, we are able to show people what this in reality is. I have to confess that normally with clients, with cities, I do simulations because otherwise they don't believe very much on these invisible forces. And these simulations, there's a lot out there in the market that you can access, but they are fundamental the skills for these tools are fundamental to learn in order to produce forward and to convince the clients and convince the policymakers that this is a reality and design can have an impact in the changing of the built environment. So having said that, I recently released a book that also claims weather as space. I was looking at the history of, let's say, some of them paradigmatic projects that have been discussed on certain lines. And I tried to unpack or to reveal also some sensibilities and commitments that the designers had. You know, Le Corbusier, that's my argument, he could not have done Chandigarh the way he did if he could not have discovered climate as matter in design, if he could not have made an alliance with André Micenar, the Transvaal of that time in the 50s. He could not have created a new language in architecture if he would not thought about thresholds, the thresholds between architecture and landscape architecture as a mediator of different climates, as means to achieve different scales of climate, small microclimates and larger microclimates. Today, what I have chosen to talk to you is a CESC Pompeia from Lina Bobardi that I will tell you later on. So in the book, you know, reclaiming the history of climate in particularly in landscape architecture and always in association with architecture, in studying further this let's say projects, I came as a series of propositions, you know, to make things also clear for all of you, also for my students. And so I set up five spatial propositions or five techniques in the assumption that atmosphere and weather are design substances, design matter. So these are atmosphere as immersive journey, atmosphere as thermal thresholds, atmosphere as program, atmosphere as shared situation, and atmosphere as thermal contrast. So what does it mean that? You know, it's kind of, it's like a guideline. You know, if we want to work as with weather and atmosphere as matter, perhaps we can use this as principle. So atmosphere as immersive journey means that we are constructing the space through movement, bringing attention to the body's episodic psychophysiological entanglement with its surrounding environment. It prioritizes climatic variety in an intermittent manner, prompting tactical on and offs, engagement with the design milieu. So it's kind of super environments on certain areas that trigger a bigger entanglement or bigger awareness, or even to say a bigger aesthetic perception, aesthetic realization, if we take Baumgarten's concept of aesthetic very literal. What you see here is Rauscham Gardens by William Kent, and which I exercise this concept or this proposition. Atmosphere at thermal thresholds addresses the boundaries between the indoors and outdoors, liquid and vapor, private and public, architecture and landscape, Each boundary expands and offers varied thermal thresholds for climatic amelioration and improved civic inhabitation. So it looks at the boundary where architecture is not a limit, or landscape is not a limit, but it's actually mediator. And I use Chandigarh. I included Chandigarh in this chapter. Atmosphere as program focus on the constructed microclimatic conditions as principal sources of delight. So there's no vistas, there's no amphitheaters, no pavilions, no eating cars. It's just pure microclimate as the program. So rather than conventional programs to activate the commons, this proposition involves ideas of silence, rest, or induced contemplation. And I used a project in Paris, Les Jardins de Bambou by Chemetov. It's a fascinating project because it's also using the geothermal cooling of these excavated surfaces and water for evaporative cooling. The fourth chapter is atmosphere as shared situation. Here, I foregrounded the civic nature of meteorological events to elicit, invite, and stimulate collective delight. Weather is a shared domain in a manner reminiscent of ancestral practices and biological dependencies on the larger cosmos. Here, I used as a base Lina Bobardi's work, in particular the CESC, because she was fascinated about the symbolic and cosmological nature of weather, because her interest on traditional knowledge, indigenous knowledge, and the symbolic nature of weather. The last is atmosphere as thermal contrast, where I position the body in more radical and unexpected environments, considering discomfort as an integral aspect of spatial experience. The amelioration or amplification of microclimatic behaviors foregrounds the body's vulnerabilities relative to climatic contrast. So what I find very interesting in this last proposition is actually designing for discomfort. And you know, we are trained to resist gravity, to design for the comfort, but what if we design for discomfort in a tactical manner? And for that, I use the Termas Geometricas, the Termas Geometricas of Germán del Sol in Chile. I have to say that all these photos are from Ivan Ban. He also traveled with me during the research of these projects. So as mentioned before, I will start with Pompeia. Is there any question now? No? It's all good? All right.
What was the name of the garden in Paris that you mentioned? Garden, Jardin de quoi?
Le Jardin de Bambou from Chemetov.
Jean Etav?
Chemetov, Chemetoff.
Ah, yes, it's here.
Alexander Chemetov. It's there, right.
Cool, thank you.
You're welcome. All right. Says Pompeia. This is a wonderful project. Perhaps it's made by woman, and I'm being totally biased by that. But Lina Bobardi is such an undermined figure in the world of architecture. I think more and more she's getting attention. No, Philippe, do you also share that opinion? All right. So the CESC.
Yes.
Right. The CESC is a community center in the blue collar neighborhood of Pompeia. This project is the result of an adaptive reuse designed between 77 and 86 in the time that the concept of adaptive reuse was not so popular. Designed by Lina Bobardi, so a Milanese architect from Milan, but then she moved to Brazil during the war, Second World War. She first stayed in Rio, was not really accepted in Rio. Then she moved to Salvador da Bahia, living with the leftists and communists community, and then doing a lot of work in São Paulo. She called this project, the CESC, this community center, the Citadel, dedicated, and she writes about it, dedicated to nurture and generating well-being for the working community. So she was really an activist, and she was using design and weather or the environment that she would create it to activate, to support the happiness of this working community, because she believed that the working community deserved that. And I have to say that this center is still super vibrant today. It has, you know, 5,000 people, you know, just visit on a Sunday or Saturday, because there's always something going on and it's very welcoming. So, you know, you can see how it was a CESC before. This is already when it got built. It was in a favela. And these people were working in this factory. So it was a factory to build engines for fridges, something like that. These kind of cylinders that you put inside of fridges and inside of washing machines. And Lina Bobardi decided to keep and retrofit the complex as a reference to the industrial history of the neighborhood, and to add the extra program with new towers and landscape in this, as you know, in this stacked concept. And she believed these were very initial drawings, as she was trying also to frame the identity of this project. She believed that this new center would shift the site's history into a new one that will be more socially integrated, empowering the community, was a place to play, where people could find some joy, intergenerational joy. So she was very committed to these principles. So Lina Bobardi, and she wrote about this, she was fascinated about ruins, because ruins for her was a perfect expression of this entanglement between architecture and landscape. You know, there was no author there. The author was this entropy process. And she believed that this entropy process could also be achieved between architecture or the space and people. And she talked, or she wrote, that architecture was a living organism in continuous interaction with its environment. And she write like a snake, like a lizard on top of a rock, you know, sitting there and just receiving the solar energy. So therefore, in this idea of living organisms, she termed the subtle substances, such as air, light, and nature, as fundamental for her architecture and fundamental for this homeostatic interaction that architecture could do with the existing environment. And by doing that, and this is when things get really interesting, it becomes also a political stance. By doing that, by integrating weather or the subtle substances in the architecture, she thought that architecture could fight the rigid status quo. The rigid status quo, meaning the economic and the political status quo, that also put these people living in a favela. So there's a political statement. And by doing that, she also believed that architecture and people living in this architecture could achieve freedom and could also achieved happiness, joy, what you call joy. So this was one, when she visited this site, this was the first thing she wrote, and I quote, "The rain was dripping through the cracked roofs. Children were running around and boys were playing soccer, laughing as they kicked the ball through the puddles. I thought, all of this should continue like this, with all this happiness. This is where the story of the design of the CESC Pompeia Cultural Center begins." Yeah, so playing with the rain, playing with the puddles, which I think puddles as a concept is fascinating. I have to write a book on puddles, because it's unpredictable. Yeah, things that appear through entropy. So the sketches that followed registered this desire to keep the found fluidity in its intersection between landscape and the happenstances, the events, the small events of the weather for people's joys and pleasure. This idea of fluidity is very much registered in the gathering center, where you see this meandering amoeba from her initial thoughts. And she called the River of San Francisco, again, a political stance. It's called the River of San Francisco, this pond, let's say. because it's also homage to the community that were living in the Northeast that was being displaced by a electro dam, hydroelectric dam. And the idea of creating this water pond or feature was not only to cool down, you know, keep in mind that São Paulo is very dry, yeah? So every water you do is actually a benefit. It's not like Miami. You don't want to have to add more water in a Miami environment because it's already humid. Yeah, it's exactly the opposite. You just want to do a design that can reduce humidity. And the best way, if you are outdoors, is just being exposed to the natural ventilation. But in São Paulo, this gets really dry during the dry season. And then it rains a lot during the wet season. But during the dry season, it's still cold. Hot, excuse me. And she created this also water feature as to generate evaporative cooling that would cool down this environment. But not only that, but also to become this civic, interactive and a group, let's say, to promote group activities. In the book, I try also to unpack, you know, to make it very clear what's happening, giving it names also for also people understand, because I think we are, as architects and scape architects, we have to own this language. Yeah, we have to increase our literacy on this. So when she visited this factory, she also noticed that the factory was already operating in a thermally sustainable manner, meaning that, for instance, And that's because, just to say a side story, is that Lina Bobardi was totally against air conditioning. She said, in every building, none of my buildings will have air conditioning. So she was trying really to work with the natural fluxes. The factory has already the roofs, the opaque roofs towards the north. So we are on the northern hemisphere. So the south, the sun goes to on the north hemisphere. During the high hours, and the windows were exposed to the dominant breezes. So she totally understood that the building was already working bioclimatically very efficiently. So she kept that. Plus, she added this the Muiba, the river of San Francisco, had also means to cool down this large space of exhibition and children, it has also a childcare and also has a senior library. So again, this idea of intergenerational space that kids and elderly could also interact in a comfortable way. So from free convection, the chimney effect that produces, so you know, there's always operable windows on those windows, the number two, in order to activate this ventilation through the space and also carry the humidity that is generated by this feature. Anyway, here's some thermographics I always carried with me to kind of to prove, you know, or to reveal this thermal contrast. You see there on the window, on the back is around 39 degrees and the water is about more than 10 degrees difference. So this is very important for the space. Symbolically, again, this idea that the hearth, fire, water and fire being together. So she never lost this, the symbolic meaning of things, putting them together, creating also a certain friction. Also in São Paulo, the nights get really cold. And she used that to attract the community to stay there longer during the night. Here's another sketch by Lina Bobardi. So on the back of this complex, she noticed that was a draining line of water that could gather, that was gathering some water, some drainage on the site and was running. And the engineers asked her to pipe the water, to put it in the pipe to be more controllable. And she said, no, I want to do this in a more natural way, in a more integrated way. So she was against the engineers. That's a kind of a cool thing. And with this, she said, okay, I have to invent something to make this water line, this trench, usable. And she created, on top of this trench, one of the most exciting spaces in the Sesc. They call the beach of São Paulo. Yeah, a Praia de São Paulo. And this is all packed with people. And what is really cool about this space is that if you are laying down, you feel in your body the cooling coming from this trench. Again, there's water, there's evaporative cooling, it's dark. So it's using the geothermal radiation from this from this trench. But on top, you feel the heat from the sun. So it creates this kind of somehow confusing situation because you don't know really where this wind or this convection is coming, and it's coming from this trench. So very indigenous, in a way, it's a natural air conditioning. And it's a very popular space. She also painted with a dark color, even to emphasize that differential, thermal differential. Another move that she did, you know, perhaps in a more metaphorical way, but, you know, I think that's what is beautiful about design, because we can be very scientific and also very symbolic. So operating again on these contrasting sensibilities or ethos. When Lina Bobardi decided not to spread the fields, the play fields on the side, and she decided to stack them to create this tower that creates a huge presence in the town, she didn't want to call it, you know, the field 1, 2, and 3. And again, we are in Brazil, so soccer is very popular. She named them according to the seasons. So even today, the people go, when they go to play, they say, you know, I go to the Primavera or o Verão field, the summer field. And for that, the way that she coded, she selected the color palette that she kind of was inspired by people's clothes, by the colors of the landscape, so on and so forth. So it's still it's a little of a paradox, because in São Paulo there's no four seasons, but still it's a very powerful idea, and particularly because people remember, very easy to register. These large windows that are so charismatic in this tower are basically to ventilate this play field. So they are exposed, oriented towards the dominant breezes. Again, this understanding where they're coming for is essential for these design decisions. But they also create this a kind of a dark atmosphere, a kind of a cooling cave. In these fields. And I think we are here on the summer field here. So the community has been, you know, very consistent in keeping these colors alive, because it seems like they work. Here you see a view from the side. So what I learned from Lina Bobardi is that to design with weather is a way to reconnect humankind with primordial and visceral sensations. It binds individuals with their biological, symbolic, and spiritual selves, reminding them that we are here on the earth and we are just part of a large interaction that sometimes is also in contact with the cosmos. Before I go, I move forward. Is any question on Lina Bobardi? Yes.
Not so much a question, but just, I know this, like, my dad's Brazilian, so it's a kind
from
of
where question. It depends always from where.
Yeah, so they're from Amazonia, but everyone lives in Brazilia. They moved to Brasilia in when Brasilia started, so
right. Wow.
Do you think, like, the success of this project, like, I understand it so much from understanding, like, a Brazilian context of, like, the connection with nature and the way that people talk, the way that people speak, like, the language and the images they use, this project uses, makes so much sense to me in this context. But do you think that it's so dependent then on like the success of this and the use of this and the way that people responded to it was so contextual to that? Like, do you think it can be extended to like a European, a Northern European, for example, where people are not used to being touching? I think like the South American, I don't know, for me, like the Brazilian context, being close, the proximity, like a very like natural relationship to people, or like a very bodily, let's say, like relationship people have with each other and with space and with nature, makes so much sense. But within a Northern European context, and I find it interesting that she was from Italy, because again, it's more that Latin thing, but I wonder how well it could translate into another context.
Well, thank you. I think that's a very important question. You know, we all come from nature in a way. We are nature, right? So we have this empathy for a normal empathy because we have an amazing genetic information or genetic memory. You know, but I think what is, perhaps this is an invitation also for you to understand what is this ancestral, visceral relationship with nature, in which context you are. I don't have an answer for that. What I know is I know that that's possible because, you know, when I do a project, I also try to understand what's happening in this culture. She also spent a lot of time there. So she included the community very much in the beginning. And I think that that's also part of the success of this project. It's very bare. The project is very bare. So there's no excess of whatsoever. There's features, follies here and there that she tries to create a shared situation in which something is celebrated. For instance, the solarium, the beach, is a shared space, but also she celebrates the design intelligence by creating this cooling, heating situation that is so pleasant that everybody enjoys it. Yeah, so it's, for me, what I would recommend to you is also to understand what is ingrained in the culture, in its understanding of nature. And I have other projects to share with you relative to this. Yeah? All right. So I will now share with you, I don't know how much time we do. How much time we do? We have?
Well, we can do 15 more minutes, I think, and then we have an hour, and then we have about half an hour of discussion. But if
15 more minutes?
Yeah, or maybe 20.
Okay, I don't know. Okay, let's do it. Yeah. So I will show you. I will show you three projects that I developed. One is Lichtung, is very much architecture. The other one is urban design. And the other one, I don't know what that is, but I will share with you. Lichtung was a project about the river. And this was a project we did a few years ago. The city wanted us to do something along the river. We didn't know what to do. We didn't know which program. You know, it was a little bit of a loss. And we tried to get into the identity, like going back, the identity, the landscape identity, the climatic identity of this project. And there was something about the Donau, the Danube, that was very mysterious, also very daunting because of its history, of its length. By the time I was doing some research on the beginning of the word landscape, you know, what landscape was there, or the meaning of landscape. And I realized that within let's say, painting and the arts, landscape as a topic was described for these paintings and perhaps earlier in other paintings. But Albert Altdorfer, he was an architect, but he was based in Regensburg, which is close by here. And he started to use landscape to describe his paintings. And it's understandable why. You know, there was not a Catholic or religious topics. He was just painting the sky and the earth. And what he did that was really perverse at this time, he neglected the horizontal format in painting. What we call the landscape painting. He started to paint vertically. And that's, for me, was, you know, astonishing to discover that. So, and within this verticality, that means like at least 2/3 of this painting is atmosphere, is the sky. So I was kind of very ingrained, focused on this topic during by then. And we started to do a video, basically. We are taking every day a photo of the river, like we call it 360 weathers because we failed some days, but I really wanted to capture this climatic identity of the river. And showing this, and that's perhaps where I think was the major objective, showing this to the people, to the community, because without community support, these projects don't go anywhere. So we were doing this to trigger the desire, to trigger the imagination. And when was an homage to the Donau, to the Danube. So our project was about reimagining how to reintegrate this project or to integrate the different projects along the Danube. And we started with a small section. We wanted to do a kind of a pilot project within one part of this. I don't have a mouse here, but you will see where it is. And we start to collect these annotations, drawings. We were on the same mindset, you know, to draw over the landscape, to create these kind of diaries as we move through to discover our site of intervention. We didn't know it yet. And we discovered this path along the river, a kind of a totally like a goat path, informal, that we wanted to integrate to claim it to our design, using the same, let's say, properties or the same methodologies by excavation, by the use of color, by the intensity of new plantations to create less or more humidity, to create more or less light. And we appropriated this pathway, and we created a system of clearings. That's why we call the project Lichtung, and Lichtung is also a kind of a philosophical concept, the opening from Heidegger, where when you are in this opening, coming out of the forest, you enter in this opening and something gets revealed to you, you are aware of something that gets into your skin, into your eye. So we created a series of clearings, and we had very little money to do it because it was a pilot project. But the project was basically intended to create a clear entrance. And we were using this yellow because it would provide contrast in the spaces of deep shadow or very low light. We also wanted to create a super mega bench that could be also a strange sculpture in the middle of this clearings and windows towards the river to invite people to stay. The excavations that you see, when I say excavations, it's a very simple technique of landscape. You just scrub the organic matter and you just leave the soil. And the soil, when it's humid and is in darkness, it has this very intense smell. So this is a very powerful atmosphere, the scent. And what is happening is that when we did that, we had actually people kind of occupying and spending time on this. And for us, it was a way to conquer this space. Another bench was put in a place that could be illuminated in the morning, for instance, or another site that could have a particular, let's say, environment, a particular Stimmung during the sunset. And, you know, I think this is the type of experience that people remember. We as designers, we can do this, and they want to go back to re-experience this moment. Then we did also, of course, thermographics, because sometimes we need to prove that we do things the way that we want to and the way and they work like that. We were using a lot of these heavy benches on concrete for thermal mass, so it could keep the cooling during the night. So during the day, the hot days, it will be cold still, or warm if it will be in winter. Here, another one. We created also in one of these clearings, and this was a temporary installation of a cloud to create this awe moment of awe, and was great because people also. Empowering this latency. And something that is there and design just kind of amplifies these potentials. And also using this, you know, this cathedral of vines, and we just added these small hammocks, and these kids, you know, very surprisingly, they came and they start to play, you know, the sad thing that the hammocks the next day, they were stolen. And I thought this was not possible in Germany, damn it, but they were. But it's a good sign, means that people were excited about it. So the other project is more on an urban scale. So this, what we saw before, is very small, where we are also trying, you know, to make things more curated, more dedicated. This, we won a competition a few years ago in the city of Lisbon. And I don't know if you've ever been to Lisbon. Lisbon has always these winds coming through, and it's a fundamental element to cooling the built environment, because Lisbon has also the, you know, seven valleys, seven hills like Rome. So when I was studying Lisbon, and probably you know, there's this anabatic and katabatic winds, the winds that run. The anabatic, for instance, come from the wind, the water or the ocean, lakes towards the mountains. And the katabatic winds are coming from the mountains to the water bodies. And this, I think, it's one of the most undervalued natural engines in cities, because they really help to cool down cities and people. In this case, I was looking into the anabatic winds, the upslope winds that come from the water to the mountains. This is Lisbon. This also occurs because it's very topographical. And in one of this analysis, our site, you see there on the top center, more or less, was actually attaching to very, very polarized situation. One that was highly exposed and the other one that was highly sheltered. The blue is a park, and the top situation is the airport. Yeah, so I started to get really curious about this polarization of conditions on temperature and on wind exposure. So on the bottom, again, we are talking about also topography. Topography is great to explore when we are dealing with climate, because there's always this engine running. Relative to the wind was also a similar situation, an area that was highly exposed, such as the airport. And this is a tip for you whenever you want to know which wind dominant you have in a city, just look at the runways. They tell you that's the case of this one and all the airports in the world. So the airport was highly exposed, and the bottom with the park was highly sheltered. So I started to think about what will be the potentials. Oh, this is wrong here. What will be the potentials of this polarization for design, for a design strategy? This is a little bit on the side, but it has to do with materiality. You know, Lisbon has this white limestone, or very kind of light beige limestone, which is great for to avoid heat gain, but also the ground is made by this kind of gravelish color, at least the old ways of doing streets. What was amazing about this system, and we tend to forget that because now we tend to impermeabilize everything with concrete or asphalt, is actually when we do this gravelish or porous ground, we are actually absorbing rain, not only to feed the aquifers, but also to evaporate later on. So it's really important to think that the way that we are doing now, cities and streets and sidewalks, could even be better if we add more porosity. What we noticed when we were doing the studies on the soil, we noticed that our site was also part of a gravel vein. So we wanted also to bring that idea of porosity, not only porosity for wind, but also porosity for rain and humidity on the site. The project became actually a corridor, what we call the ventilation corridor. A funnel that could negotiate the thermal and the wind asymmetries of the adjacent areas, because we knew that engine, ventilation engine, would always occur, and particularly because it will always be activated or reactivated with the anabatic winds. And by the anabatic winds, by utilizing the anabatic winds, we also knew or could estimate that the humidity through evapotranspiration that was aggregated on the park could also go and being carried by the antibiotic queens during the afternoon when the built environment is already hot because it's collecting heat throughout the day. So we were excited about that idea. We also excited about the notion of asymmetry and for climate. Please write that down. Asymmetry is fundamental. Yeah, because you know we tend to do streets all the time symmetrical. I still don't get it. Why are we still doing that? And I try to convince every time my students, if you have a street exposed to the east and west, there's different heat gains on that. And the west that is exposed to the west gonna gain more heat. And that may be a problem, a hazard. So we took this idea of asymmetry and we tried to sculpt this wall that is exposed to the east. So it more, yeah, as you see in that, this crooked wall, because we would see that, so they are oriented towards east, south, but they will be like cooling oases in the project. But also a place that could also collect the humidity, collect the wind, because you would have some jetties, jetties, eddies happening there. So to increase ventilation and the cooling of the students. And by the way, this was a student residency and a new neighborhood for Lisbon. The porosity of the ground. So in this project, so we won the competition. The city was very excited about it. They used the guiding principles of this project to provide the protocols for urban development. And then the crisis came and then, yeah, it stopped. But this is to say that concepts of anabatic, adiabatic winds, concepts of porosity, concepts of humidity being carried with wind, orientation can do a lot already. And we are not talking about very complicated things. It's just how to be strategic about these elements. Of course, we did a simulation. You know, there's nothing that we can simulate on humidity, but we did a small simulation on particles, on how this humidity once carried by the anabatic winds could perform in these spaces, because we wanted these notches, these kind of dents, open small plazas to operate as cooling spaces. And here's some details of the design, and here's some simulations again to convince the client that this was operating the way that we imagined. So during the winter, it's still exposed, yeah, to allow the clients and the students that are here to be exposed to the sun. And during the summer, it's also sheltered against the shortwave radiation, with also the added trees that we inserted here. The final project is a competition we did a few years ago for the MoMA. We were finalists. We didn't do the project. They didn't choose us as the winners. I say that it's fine, but it's not fine. I was really upset about it because I thought the project was great. We did it with Transolar, and we wanted to transform solar to ice. We want to use ice as design matter. It's called the Beastie because of this. During that time, I was reading a lot about environmental criticism, and it's claimed on these studies, environmental criticism and many authors, that beasts are known or claimed to have emerged during moments of climatic disruption. For instance, the emergence of let's say, Count Dracula, Jack the Ripper, Frankenstein, and Godzilla have been, or the moment in which they appear, the context, have been synchronized with moments of atmospheric anomalies, thick air from dense airborne pollution, sulfurous sky, diurnal darkness, steady temperature decline, and radioactive fallout, such as a Godzilla when he emerged immediately after the Second World War. So embody fear or awe, fear, these beasts are mirrors, or I think that's the argument, that these beasts are mirrors of one's relation to the disrupted atmosphere. So if these beasts appear during this time, you know, what would be a new beast? What would be the beast of nowadays? So that was, for me, was the question of the project. And of course, during that time, you know, the melting of the ice in the caps of mountains in the Arctic was very present, and it is very present. And it came to my curiosity to do a project about ice as let's say as a material premise for cooling. When you look, you know, there's also the research part of the project. I was very taken by this example, the ice houses in Persia, you know, thinking about doing, you know, ice in the desert. Who is from Iran? You may know this. You may know this. Where is the student that was from Iran? Yeah. So she may know this very well. This is an amazing thing, you know, creating ice in the desert, you know, such an invention. But, you know, they do it that, they did it because they understood it by experimenting the thermodynamic interactions during the day and the night that's happening in the desert. As you know, sleeping in the desert during the night is damn cold. You need to have a bear tent or a tent to protect because it's really, really cold. But during the day, it's very hot. So what in these houses, what they did, they create a very thin layer of water that is fed through a kanat, that is the subterranean channels. They put this very thin water line on the north side of a wall. So it gets frozen. So it gets a very thin layer of ice. And right before when the sun comes, they take it and put it inside of these chambers. And these chambers, as you see from the section, it's like a cooling heaven, because not only is utilizing the radiant cooling from the earth, but it's also creating this huge thermal mass that keeps this cold inside with a very, very small opening. It actually reminds me of the Pantheon when I see this. So this is an amazing structure. When I saw that, I said, okay, if someone is able to do ice in the desert, perhaps we can make also a nice ice for this, for my new beastie. And of course, this beastie was a statement about HVACs. We know that cooling by convection is not very effective. The most optimized method of cooling or heating is by conduction. Philip, we could discuss very much about that. If you touch, you cool faster or you warm faster. And I was thinking that if you touch the ice, so you're going to cool faster. So, you know, could we use ice in the future for a cooling mechanism for touching? Of course, I don't know if you know about these parties at MoMA. This was a pavilion for the PS1 MoMA summer parties. So you go there, you drink, you get wasted, you dance the whole afternoon. It's really fun. So I can imagine all these hipsters dancing and being really hot during these events. So for me, the beastie was this cooling folly, but I needed sun. So we did these simulations also to test the capabilities of the site, and the site is a small courtyard, and it's called PS1 because it's public school one, so it was a former school. So the site has a lot of sun. So, and that was what we needed. And I will explain to you then the process. So in summary, the beastie, as it came, we said that it's a friendly refrigerator because it transforms solar heat into ice without energy, without electricity coming from the grid. It's a cooling pavilion for the hot summer days with thermally active inactive material. And is an architectural folly in tune with people and weather. And I will explain that better. So here's see some drawings that are part of this submission. Here more views on the courtyard of MoMA with a shower, and I will show you that later. Here, so the project is actually very simple. It's using the kind of a greenhouse structure. It had a lot of curtains by these PVC curtains that you see in these cooling, refrigerating areas when you go to a supermarket. And it had areas enclosed, these circles, where we'd call the grottos. And these grottos is where these vertical pipes would gather. And the pipes are part of the system that we created with Transolar. So we would have the PV panels on the roof of these greenhouse structures that would feed into a compression chiller. So the compression chiller would transform the electricity or the energy from these photovoltaics. They would cool down the ammonia to sub-zero temperatures to absorb the humidity. So the ammonia was running into these pipes to absorb the humidity of the air. And New York is really humid. So this process would create ice around these pipes. And more together they are, cooler the environment would be. So this would be an example of one of these grottos. So if you would be really hot after dancing for 2 hours, you could come here to cool down. And as you cool down, you also melt the ice. And that's what this empathetic relationship that I find it very, very elegant as well. So the system, so we had to prove that this was possible. And also we would borrow these materials from the firms that wanted to participate, to collaborate in this enterprise. Transolar also did a mock-up to show that this was possible. So they created a small chiller, compression chiller in their lab, being fed by solar panels. And during this time, we were already testing what would be the materiality of these pipes, either pipes in plastic or in metal. Of course, we wanted to be in metal because it's more sturdy. But the experience also, this experiment also showed us that the ice around these metal pipes will be fluffier and nicer. And we were very happy about that. So basically, if it's fluffier, you can touch it without getting attached to it, stuck into it, and also appears faster. The other dimensions that this project created has to do with multiplicity. And I think this is really important for landscape architecture and also for architecture. And Le Corbusier was fascinated about the issue of this mur exotherme that would create several temperatures, but at the end, they would give one temperature only. But the differential temperatures, it's a way of inclusivity. Because as I said before, not everybody has the same temperature, body temperature. And what we realize is that these multi-layers of the skins of curtains could also provide different temperatures. And according to your metabolism, then you could choose which place you'd like to hang out a little bit, to drink your beer. And here is kind of a projected change throughout from 3 to 9 p.m. At 3, it opens really at the high sun, high heat during the summer events, and people could move according to their choice. According to Transolar, inside of this pavilion, as an average value, would get approximately 6 degrees less. So let's say if the temperature, mean radiant temperature outside will be 33, which is really hot summer day, the inside will be 27. So sufficient for your body to exchange, to give energy back to the surrounding environment. And then we're also playing with reflections, this kind of caterpillar finish, iridescent film to reflect the light and give different colors. But anyway, we didn't win. They were a little bit worried about the technical apparatus of it, but there's also identity politics in these competitions that you don't have anything to say about it. So I will share with you. Do you hear?
Yes.
But this has a song, and I would like you to hear the song. It's really important to hear the song. Let me see. There's a share screen, and I will share sound. Okay. Do you hear the song?
Yes, we do.
Great.
I be your mirror? Reflect what you are, in case you don't know. I be the wind, the rain and the sunset, the light on your door, to show that you're home. When you think the night has in your mind, that inside you're twisted and unkind, let me stand to show that you are blind. Please put down your hands, 'cause I see you. I find it hard to believe you don't know the beauty you are. But if you don't, let me be your eyes, a hand to your darkness, so you won't be afraid. When you think the night has in your mind, that inside you're twisted and unkind, let me stand to show that you are blind. Put down your hands, 'cause I see you.
Right, so the new Beastie, yeah, that is the final conclusion for me. The new Beastie, like Nico is saying, that's why I say music is important, is a mirror reflecting our vulnerabilities, such as the melting ice in the context of climatic degradation. So it's kind of empathetic thing going on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sylvia.
It was I don't.
Yeah, I think you have to.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. It was really good, really interesting. And so I think it is really helpful for a student. So thank you very much. Me, I have a question about the project, the urban project with the urban wind.
Right.
And you are talking about the two sides of the street. So can you just explain a little, because one is like straight and the other one is doing like that.
Right.
Can so you just explain me what's happened with this, the west side of the street?
So the one was a straight line just to, you know, to support wind flow. The other one was like notches. They're like cuts because we want to create some jetties, some turbulences, to increase ventilation during during the summer.
Okay. Okay. I think also your drawing are very nice, very beautiful.
Thank you. Yeah, it takes a lot of time to do drawings, right? It's like, it's not only about the principle, then you have to curate all these drawings, which I spend a lot of time.
Is someone have a comment or?
I think this would be more like a comment than a question, but thank you so much for the presentation. Super interesting and also very inspiring. I remember writing, I had to write a paper like in critical conservation class, and I wrote about CES Pompeia.
Right.
But the whole time was really writing about symbolic. So it's so nice to see what you talk about. But then I really very much appreciate when you talk about like the idea that you can be both technical and also, you know, like be symbolic and poetic, because that's something also the students are struggling with. And I feel like that's what you have really achieved with your projects as well. And I think what stayed with me the most was when you commented, because I never thought about this way. Like I'm from Vietnam and, you know, like thinking about conservation and thinking about how people appreciate nature, worship, and also like design with nature or weather. But I never thought that it's actually by designing with nature, you are creating a kind of connection on a spiritual level with the right. cosmic. I just thought it's so like mind blowing to think about from that perspective. And that makes me feel a little better about like, you know, you can be both symbolic and be poetic and be put yourself into the work while you can still be scientific, technical, and, you know, solve right. real world problems. So I thought it's just so nice to hear what you say and how you've done it. Thank you.
You know, sometimes we use several hats as architects. Yeah. Sometimes you have to be really dumb. Yeah. So
yeah. And because, you know, when you present, like I went to the GSD as well. And then when you present your project, of course, like you're not supposed to be like, yeah, you know, I like it. But you always have to have a reason behind it. But then oftentimes, especially with being a student, it's hard to be both. And you feel discouraged when you get a like, kind of negative or like not very nice feedback on your work because you are being a little symbolic or you're trying to do this and that.
You know, perhaps that's when we need to spend also a lot of time in our drawings. I think our drawings, sometimes you don't need to say anything.
Mm-hmm.
But if they convey something, you know, the other person gets also touched about it.
Yeah,
you
know what I mean? Totally agree.
And
yeah.
they, you know, perhaps we understand sacredness. You know, when you see a photo of Barragan,
mm-hmm.
yeah, for instance, or when you saw the image of that ice house,
mm-hmm.
you don't need to say too much. Everything yeah. is there. You know what I mean?
Exactly. Yeah. So that's what I think too, like architecture is also about representation, because even if you
yeah.
think you don't.
Or by, you know what, I've been very resistant to the word of representation because mm-hmm. it has been used and used. Mm-hmm. But it's narrating a story.
Mm-hmm.
It has the power of narrating certain properties.
Mm-hmm.
It's narrating. Yeah, it's telling us a story. Mm-hmm. It's like a novel, like reading Italo Calvino in a drawing.
Yes. I like how you talk about it. It's very nice. Thank you.
Perhaps I asked the class, which one was your favorite project? And don't say Linda Bobardi, because that will be unfair. Or a question about one of the projects. What?
I would say Lina Bobardi, but I cannot. So I would say the second one with the river.
Mm-hmm. The first one.
The first one, yeah.
Right. The small one. Yeah, it's very small, very low budget. We have to be really concentrating our efforts.
Yeah, but also I was really surprised by like the little also intervention that you integrate along this river. It's a nice way also. Comparing to like the other project was really like it also because it's another scale for me it was like I really appreciate this project.
Thank you. You know, and Philippe, you know very well when you are dealing with cities, you know, it's so complicated because it's so always the question, when is design too much? You are always trying to calibrate because some cities get really nervous when it's too much, because they think that the community gonna understand that as a settled project. It's like, oh, they decided everything. But then there's moments that you really have to step back from your ambition not only because of budget, but also from your ambition. You know, we like to build things. We like to put a lot of things. That's part of our mindset. But, you know, to step back is also important, even, you know, it's complex, but we have to be aware of it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And thank you for your presentation. It was really helpful.
Cool.
I like the rolling chair.
Yeah, thinking while moving.
I like the MoMA just because thinking about how successful the weather project was when it was happening in the Tate and seeing how well people responded to this space in which they could somehow, that I don't know, like all the projects that have happened in the turbine hall in London, right. I think it's really interesting to see like how much the public actually enjoy them, especially in experiencing art or understanding a concept that maybe you don't come into contact with that often.
Yeah.
And I think obviously MoMA is another one of those spaces, but doing something where people really like are together and you have something which is non-verbal, which something which is physical, I think people do relate to concepts very differently on like a different level. So I think like this idea of really bringing that to people was really nice in like quite a literal way. I thought that was like successful. Right. I'm sorry that you did not win, because I think it would have been nice, especially understanding like the context of, yeah, New York in the summer. It would have been great.
I know, that's why I tried to convince the jury that was the best, yeah, you know, we're gonna be hot. And then they ended up choosing a project that was built in this dark metal. Can you imagine dark metal? People fry eggs, they could not even sit on it.
Yeah, no, so I thought that was good. And yeah, I think the comment that Fee made now as well of like, your drawing is, so I didn't study architecture before, so I'm really like coming to terms with what architecture means within drawing. And I really enjoyed the fact that you were using like a watercolor over your drawings. It added like a softness and like an element of like a not controllability is not a word, but like a fluidness, which I think I haven't really seen that much within architectural imagery, and I thought was really interesting within like the thinking about the climax. I think a lot of the schemas that I've been drawing especially are really quite hard and like diagrammatic and like schema, like, you know, scheme. Yeah. So finding this way of articulating that like fluidity or movement or like the naturalness, I guess, of it, like the non-technical side of it, I found was really interesting. And they have brought a poetry to the projects, which I really appreciate. And yeah, that this problematic of like, it's not necessarily like what Philip's been talking about, this problematic of like the postmodern being like super layered with meaning over anything else, all being about a narrative. I don't think we've quite moved on from that personally. I think that's still like overhanging in so much of what we do. And I think like this kind of relation of like reality with like a postmodern condition, I think is like kind of where we are now. So it was really interesting, yeah, to hear you like talk about like how can we do that. And I think your drawings were like a really perfect example of
of thank that. You. So
thank you for sharing those.
You're welcome. Thanks for your comments. Next. Next rolling chair. Oh, here you go. That's great. Thank you.
Yes, maybe I will say a bit, Camilla, I really like your project of MoMA, the way of combining poetry and architecture. I think it's interesting and it's not always seen in architecture.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. And also your drawing, did you make it or how? Okay.
Yeah, we used watercolor.
Okay.
Actually, it was inspired by very early thermodynamic studies from the 19th century. I just copied. I don't know. I was very inspired. I didn't know what to do. And I saw these drawings and I was, maybe I should copy the engineers.
It's changed from the technical drawing, and I think it's convincing.
Yeah, thank you. But I had a lot of pleasure in doing that.
Well, thank you for your conference. It was very interesting.
Thank you.
Mm.
Lovely.
We have more technical question, but which yep. program are you using to do the thermal rendering?
I'm using Diva.
Diva.
Which has been now discontinued, and it's Climate Studio.
Okay.
Climate Studio. Which program is it, like a plugin for Revit or
which Climate Studio and Diva were Grasshopper plugins. Well, Climate they are plugins for Rhino, but Climate Studio now allows you to do more more functions, allowing also to link to Grasshopper.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay, thank you, Sylvia. I think someone want to say something?
This is the last call of this train. But I will see you again, right?
Yes, for the final review.
I will make sure that I have a lot of questions for you.
So, and now the level of representation is high, so it's good.
Oh God, yeah, I will demand for that. Okay. Yeah, it was very nice. Nice meeting you all. And Philippe, thank you again for the invitation. It was great to see you and to chit-chat a little bit.
And for me, it was also really good to see your project. And some project I didn't know, you know, the one for with the street. So,
right.
Yeah. So it's yeah. Really good. Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. Have a great evening.
Thank you, the student. Bye. Good night. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you, Sylvia.
Ciao, ciao.